Oh, very nice talks. And so now I am going to present some works that we have been doing over the last two or three years, but it's a continuation of things which started many years ago. And it has to do with large deviations for typically exclusion processes. But in the first part, I will talk about a general Markov process. And most of the work comes from collaborations with Tridib Sadhu and Uri Hirschberg, but it is based on much older things with Joel Lebovitz, Jean Speer, and Thierry Bodineau. Okay, so the outline, first I will discuss large deviations for somehow general Markov process, and then I will present the more recent results we have both on the symmetric exclusion process, or maybe on more general diffusive system when we did a condition on the current. Okay, so let me talk first about large deviation. So imagine that you have some Markov process, which is specified by some matrix. So it's a finite set of possible configurations. And then you have just take a discrete time Markov process. So it's given by a matrix, which says, with what probability the system will jump from one configuration C to a configuration C prime. And then you follow configuration as a function of time at discrete time. And then you can be interested in what you call, say, an empirical function or empirical measure, so a function QT, which is a sum over a certain time T, capital T, of a function of the configurations and also of a function of two consecutive configurations. So if you think, for example, you could have in mind that M, the matrix is just the transition matrix of exclusion process, C, the configuration of the occupation of the particles, and then you have probability of some jumps, and F would be a function of the configuration, for example, the density at time t, and g would present the current, and measure the current, because it's when you jump from configuration ct to ct plus one, this is the current. Okay, and the question of large deviation is that imagine that you have a very long time window here, and then you ask, what is the probability that during this time window, this quantity takes a value t times small q? Okay, so the typical picture will be that the system, before you enter this window, will be in some kind of steady state, and then during this time window, it will reach a quasi-steady state, it will be fluctuate around some configuration here, but still, because you condition on this time interval, then already at time zero, it will not be in steady state. And of course, at time capital T, it won't be in the steady state. And then you would like to know, for example, what is the, so this is again the same picture. For example, you could ask, what is the probability that at a certain time, small t, before, between the in this time window, the system is in a certain configuration C, given that given this large deviation function. So you can condition, ask what's the probability of this configuration C at time t, or what's the probability that you see the particle, the system jumping from C to from CT to CT plus one when you condition on QT. So what is, in other words, what is the measure during this time window at the beginning, at the end? What is also the dynamics within this time window? Now, the way to do it is, especially if you have a finite dimensional Markov process, a finite set of configurations, is that you start with this Markov matrix, and then you tilt it. And the way to tilt it, if you are interested in the quantity Q, which is there, okay, unfortunately, it does not work. If you are interested in this quantity Q, then you tilt the matrix in this way, and you end up with a new matrix. This matrix is not a Markov matrix, but if you are interested in the large deviation function of the quantity Q, so it was this phi of Q, which was my previous transparency, it will be related to the largest eigenvalue of this tilted matrix. So this is probably very well known. And the point is that this tilted matrix, this tilted matrix has some eigenvectors on the left, on the right. And if you ask, and using these eigenvectors, you can answer the questions I posed at the beginning. For example, if you ask what is the probability of seeing a certain configuration at time zero, so you remember a condition over this time window, so what is the probability of seeing a certain configuration at time zero, it will be given up to normalization by the right eigenvector with lambda equals zero and the left eigenvector with the lambda. If you ask what is the probability at time t, it will be just the right eigenvector as a function of lambda. And more interesting is that if you ask what happens in the, in between, that is far from this boundary, you see close to this boundary, there are time-dependent effects. So if you ask what is the probability that I observe a certain configuration far from the, in the middle of the window, or just at time very far from zero and t, then it will be just the left eigenvector driving the right eigenvector of this matrix. Okay, so that's true for all the Markov processes, at least when they are in there are a finite set of configurations. Okay, and in fact, you see, in fact, there is a lot of symmetry between these formulas. So I have added this here because what happens is that at time t, you could multiply by the left eigenvector, which is just one. So if you write it this way, it's very symmetric, this three formula. But in fact, knowing the tilted matrix, we can also talk about the whole trajectory here at the beginning, at the end, and so on. Now you can ask if you are conditioning on this quantity capital Q, you could ask what does the dynamics look like in this time window. And here I am writing what is the dynamics far from the boundary. And the dynamics is just that you have another Markov process. And this Markov process is given by the tilted matrix. And then you multiply by the left eigenvector and the eigenvalue this way. And you can easily check that this is a Markov process. So this is the way the system will behave, the modified dynamics when you condition on this quantity capital Q. So this is general. And just to illustrate it, there is a very simple example that the physicists would call a quantum dot, which would be an exclusion process with a single site. And so imagine that you have just a single site with some boundaries. Then, of course, the system has two possible states. So the matrix, the Markov matrix is 2 by 2. So alpha, beta, gamma, delta are the rates at which particles enter and leave the system. And then the tilted matrix, if you are interested, so the tilted matrix is if you are interested just in the occupation of the site would be tilted this way. If you are interested by the current, that is the current would be the number of particles which go from the left to the right, this would be the tilted matrix. And then you can use what I said to calculate everything. But of course, this is not the most interesting case. Now, if you want to go from this to a truth, SEP or ASEP or whatever, then instead of having a one site, you have L sites. So the matrix is 2 to the L by 2 to the L. And of course, this makes the thing much more difficult. Okay, so now I am just going to try to use that. Yes.
Just to make sure. So what you say, for instance, is that if you want to impose a current on average on a long time interval, the optimal way to realize this constraint is to always do the same thing in the middle.
Okay, here it's a finite dimensional system. Yes, I think.
Okay.
Yes, I would say that. Yes.
Okay, so that.
Okay, when you say something, generalize that, one always tries to see whether there is an obvious counterexample, but a priori, yes, this is what I would say. Okay, so now let me, I'm going just to mention some more recent results, and it is just the extension of works that we have been doing many years ago. So let me remind you very quickly what these works were and then tell you what is new. Many years ago, we just tried to look at the large deviations of the density. So for a system at equilibrium, you would have many particles in a box, say, and then you would, for example, consider the number of particles in a sub-region here, in this sub-region, and the large deviation function would be what is the probability that in this sub-region, I see a density R, which is not the surrounding density rho. Yes, so everywhere you have a density rho, and then this you can ask this question whether the particles are interacting or not, and it's an exclusion process or an Ising model or whatever. Okay, and so this is a large deviation function, and it turns out that at equilibrium, the large deviation function is the free energy. So usually it has a shape like that with a minimum at rho. Sometimes you have some flat parts or something when you have a coexistence between several phases, but typically this is a large deviation function of the density. And now you could ask slightly more general things, that instead of specifying the density in one box, you could have many boxes and ask what the probability that I observe a density rho one in the first box, rho two in the second, and so on, rho k. So it would be a large deviation function which would depend on the rho one, rho k. Okay, at equilibrium, essentially it's a ratio of partition functions. Does not matter so much for this talk. And if you take more and more boxes as a very large system, then instead of specifying the densities in each box, you would have a function rho of x, and then you would have a functional f of this density. So this is typically the large deviation functional for the density of a system. And the question, of course, is whether you can predict it, calculate it, and so on. And for the symmetric exclusion process, in fact, so I think probably here you don't need to redefine the problem, but here it was the case of a symmetric exclusion process on a finite interval. So again, it's a Markov process with 2 to the L configurations, then with some rates at the boundaries. You can ask what is this large deviation function of the density. And in fact, this is the kind of result we had about 20 years ago that I am going to mention. And more recently, people have been interested in several people are here, in fact. They have been interested in the case of the fact that the contacts with reservoirs are essentially due to this rate. This is a way to mimic a reservoir of particles. It's just to fix the rates at the left boundary and the right boundary, and then it corresponds to reservoirs which would have these two densities here. So being out of equilibrium would mean that the densities of the two reservoirs are different, and then there would be the typical situation will be a flow of particles through the system. And so we had these results many years ago, and what happened is that the question was raised, what happens is if the contacts with the reservoirs are very small. And in fact, there are a number of results over the years, but the place where things really depend in an interesting way is when the contacts are of order one of the system size. You see, if they are stronger, essentially the system will behave as when they are of order one. If they are weaker, essentially the system will be at equilibrium at a certain density intermediate. But if you want something non-trivial steady state, then essentially you should take this rate of order one over L in order to be different from the normal case. Okay, so when the contacts are strong, when these rates are of order one, the result which was obtained, so I go rather quickly on it, which was obtained about 20 years ago by us and also by the group in Rome, including Claudio, which is here, was to find this probability of observing a certain density rho. And it was this formula, somehow we had to find the sup over all monotone functions of this functional. Okay, whatever, we had an exact result. Now the question is how this exact result is modified by when you take weak contacts with the reservoirs. So in order to take weak contacts, one way, okay, the way to parameterize it is to say that we choose the parameters at the boundaries to be of one, as I said, of order 1/L, and we made this choice, but the precise choice will not matter so much. And it turns out that when we try to compute, okay, that's the main message about these weak contacts. When we try to compute the correlation functions for the weak contacts and to compare them to the strong contacts, the only difference is that the system with weak contacts is the same as a system with strong contacts, but larger. So in other words, if you take the top system, which is weak contacts, where the alpha, beta, and so on are of order 1/L, then essentially all the correlation functions inside between site 1 and L are the same as if you had a larger system with strong contacts. And how large the system is, the parameter gamma, which is there, would appear here, and the other one appears there. So essentially, the problem is we have the solution because we knew already what happens for a system with strong contacts. And so for weak contacts, it's just you increase the size here and the size there. Okay, so that's one of the results. So let me just. Okay, so this, for example, you can see it when you compute the average profile. Okay, so this is an explicit calculation, but it turns out that the way all the correlations are computed, it always tells you that you just have the system, small system, the system with weak contacts is the same as the system with strong contacts, which is larger. Okay, so I skip that part, which is based on how these calculations were done. It was using this matrix and that and so on, but I don't think it's so interesting for this audience. And now let me come to the question I asked at the beginning. That is, imagine I take now this exclusion process. But in fact, what I'm going to say, I think the results are more general than the exclusion process. And then you let it evolve. And so during a certain time t, you will observe a certain current q of t. Q of t is just the total number of particles which have crossed the system during time capital t. You see, it's an algebraic number because particles can flow this way or that way. You might have fluctuations and so on. And then the large deviation function, as we said, would be what is the probability that this total number during a time window capital T, how it depends on this coefficient Q. And usually you have a large deviation function, as I said, phi of Q, and this phi of Q, you can compute it if you take this tilted matrix that we discussed at the beginning. Now, this old result with strong contacts was the following, is that it turns out that this function phi of Q, or rather its Lejeune transform, we could get an exact expression for it. Yes?
Sorry, I'm just a little bit confused about how do you choose what is the parameter lambda? How do you choose lambda? Is there a relation between small q and lambda?
Sorry, how I put this lambda? So this is a generating function of qt.
Okay.
Yes. So imagine I let the system evolve. I measure this qt, and I look at the generating function of this qt, and then the relation between mu and phi is that just they are Lejeune transform. So if you know mu, then you make the Lejeune transform, you get phi. This answers your question? No? So anyway, it turns out that one could get, so when we had strong contacts, we could get an exact expression for this mu of lambda for the symmetric exclusion process. In fact, if you had also some asymmetry, also we could also get it. But anyway, the answer, whatever it is written here. Mu of lambda is a function of this parameter, and it just is arc sinh. Okay. Now there is something surprising somehow that everything depends on a single parameter. We look always in over different geometries, in fact, even on two dimensions, three dimensions, and so on. And it's all, and one can prove it that everything will depend on a single parameter. You see, instead, a priori, it's a function of the densities on the of the two reservoirs plus this parameter lambda, which essentially is the same as Q, okay, up to this Lejeune transform. And it turns out that the result is always a function of this omega. But okay, doesn't matter so much. And the one way of finding it, in fact, what we developed with Thierry Bodino some years ago, but in fact, it's very much based on the macroscopic fluctuation theory that Bertini and Claudio and their collaborators have developed, is the idea that on a macroscopic scale, what happens is that if you want to condition on a certain current Q, capital QT was Q times T. So if I want to observe a certain current during time T, what I have, to, what the system will do is that it will have a typical density profile, which is the optimal one to flow this current. And what is this optimal profile? It is given by the rho of x, which will minimize this function. So phi of q is just the minimum over all density profiles rho of x of this functional. So this is essentially what came out for this question of this macroscopic fluctuation theory, but you can use it, of course, in many other contexts. So you try to find this minimum. And of course, what you have to do is, of course, rho is the density, j in principle is the current, and then you have the densities at the boundary. And just very quickly, but here it's written more for physicists than for mathematicians, because the way to think of it is that this functional here is a Gaussian. It tells you that J times L plus rho prime is Gaussian. So it means that the current is follows Fourier's law, which would be that, plus some white noise, which is here. Okay, so since the beginning of the week, nobody writes it that way, but this is the way physicists would write it. But, okay, so the question we tried to ask was, again, because of this interest or this weak contacts, is what happens if instead of having strong contacts at the boundaries, you take weak contacts. So again, that the rates alpha, gamma, and so on are of order one over L. And turns out that So in the case of strong contacts, as I said, we know what is the phi. Now, in the case of weak contacts, we found that the it's more conjecture than found, but we checked it, as I am going to say. But we said that the probability of observing a certain current through this system, so when there are few contacts. You have to find the maximum over rho one, rho two of the bulk, what you have for strong contacts. And then you have a part coming from this first bond. This would be the large deviation function of the current through a single bond. And the current through a single bond is a very easy thing to do because it would be like a one particle or even a zero particle, zero site Markov process. So this is a very easy quantity. And the same on the right. So essentially, the large deviation function, when you have weak contacts, you have to optimize over the density of site rho one on the site L. So essentially what the system does physically is that instead of having the first site, the beginning of the system and the end of the system at the densities of the reservoirs, it just tries to find different densities, rho one and rho two, and just try to find the optimum. So essentially, this formula, we have checked it in a low density expansion up to fourth order. It doesn't matter. But I think the reason why it works is rather simple, is that you see, when you have weak contacts, the time scale of the jumps near the boundary are very slow. And when they are very slow, this means that the bulk has time to equilibrate very well. So essentially, when a particle jumps, by the time that the next particle will enter the system, inside here, it has time to equilibrate. And so it will equilibrate at a certain density rho one. So this is the reason of that. And when you do the algebra, then you find that in terms of contact, of these weak contacts, then the large deviation function or the generating function of Q would be given by this formula, whatever it is. But we have checked it, as I said, in low densities expansions, and it works. I don't know. In fact, maybe Claudio knows how to solve it. In general, I'm not totally sure.
Is this formula for L goes to infinity, yes, or is it an exact formula?
This is for L goes to infinity. Yes, L goes because to otherwise, if L is finite,
no, just the way it was written.
There is no weak and the strong. Yes. Okay. Now, so anyway, the picture that we have for this problem with weak contacts that we looked at is just the first thing I told you, that if I take the exclusion process, then the system with weak contacts is the same as a system, a larger system with strong contacts with the reservoir. That's one thing. But that's not the same, that's not true for the current. For the current, it's a different story. One thing that we could do because of what I said earlier, that when you have these weak bonds, very quickly the bulk equilibrates. So in fact, you could have something like not a single weak contacts, but you could have slow bonds through the system, and you would have similar things that you could do. Now, the results for the symmetric exclusion process for the density are very specific to the exclusion process, because it was based on the idea that you can compute all the correlation functions, and then you observe that the correlation functions with weak contacts are the same as those of a larger system with strong contacts. And on the other hand, the reasoning for the current should be valid for over diffusive system, because essentially when you have weak contacts, the system has time to equilibrate. Whenever a particle enters or leaves, it has time to equilibrate near the boundary. And so this idea that the large deviation function is the sum of three parts, I think should be true in general. Okay, but this will not be true for the density. So this, in fact, I have some more material because I have time. So in fact, probably this is the most important aspect, because what I said was very special. So if I come back to the initial problem, I have a time window. And for example, I might be interested in asking, what is the density as the function of x and t? What is the density in the system given that I specify the current? So imagine I have an exclusion process or an over diffusive system, and you can ask, what is the probability that if I condition on the current in this time window, I see some density, and how this density would evolve in time, and so on. So the quantity that you could ask, it's what is the probability that I see a certain density at time t, given the initial density at time zero and qt. This is typical of a situation. Or you could ask, imagine that you have a certain, what is the density profile at some intermediate time, given, okay, condition on the current and condition on the initial condition. Now, according to this macroscopic fluctuation theory, what you would expect is the following, is that if the time is very large, first time is supposed to be very large. So let's time first to be very large. So you expect that it would decay like exponential minus t phi of q. But there would be some prefactors which depend on what is the initial condition and what is the final final state. You see, if you specify what you want at the initial condition on this final state, you see, because the system has a finite relaxation time, it's it always would decay like exponential minus T phi q, but there will be some free factors which depend on what you start from and what you end up with. And this is what you see at the beginning of my talk. I talked about the left eigenvector and the right eigenvector. And for these systems on large scale, this would be the quantity which represents this left and right eigenvectors, psi left and psi right. And now you could ask what the system does when you are in the intermediate region, or what is the system does at time zero and time t. And if I just know this psi left and psi right, I can answer this question. And for example, if you are in this time window, if you are in the middle, the probability of observing a certain density profile would be just psi left, the large deviation function would be just psi left plus psi right. Okay, so essentially this is what I wanted to say. And in fact, computing this psi left and psi right is hard. So we have done it at low densities by some expansion, but it turns out that it's not like what we had for the large deviation of the density when we don't condition, where we have some exact result. At the moment, we don't know how to compute this except expanding them in low density expansion. But if you ask, for example, what is the dynamics in this intermediate region, so very far from time zero and time t, just in the bulk, in the middle here, what is the dynamics? And the dynamics is just Fourier's law plus this term which contains the psi left. So this is essentially what I wanted to say, and it's based on these three papers which was published with Tridib, Sadhu, and one of the one with free contacts with Ori Hirschberg. Okay, thank you very much.
We have time for some questions.
So you discarded the case in which you have a very even slower contact with the boundary, but there you expect something different in which you will first reach equilibrium with respect to one density, and then this density evolve. So there you expect two time scales, different time scales. So
yes, but you see here I discussed essentially the steady state. So the steady state would be yes, I did not talk really about the dynamics, but in the steady state the system will reach some constant density. Is it not the case? No?
Yes, but I think that you have two different exponential cost. One to do a fluctuation with the fixed density, and another one to change the total density.
Yes. Yes, you are right. Yes. Yes, and which would come just the price you need to pay to
in order to.
Okay. Fine.
Is this a question online by Beatrice Salvador, which she asked what you expect when you take even weaker boundary conditions, something of the order one over L to the
beta, which is so, exactly I'm what sorry, we asked. We concentrated on this.
Yes.
I did not look carefully, and you're totally right about this weaker thing.
Any other questions?
So in the last question you show us, in just your previous slide, this operator in the left, the row.
Yes.
It's an unlocal operator.
Yes, of course, because the psi left and psi row are non-local. Yes, yes.
Cédric, you want to ask it directly?
Thanks. Okay. Hi, Bernard. I'm sorry, I didn't understand if you are able to compute.
Cédric Bernardin is asking.
Oh, okay. Yes.
Sorry. You are able to compute the non-equilibrium free energy in the case of the slow bond or not at the end? You say it is the same as the equilibrium free energy of
yes.
So exactly. The only difference is I have just to take the usual formula with a directed boundary condition, and I just add this gamma IA and gamma L.
Okay. So what you have to do, sorry, so where it is. Okay, so you have to say, if I have weak bounds, it's the same as a larger system with normal bounds. And now if you ask, what is the probability of seeing a certain density profile here in the middle, yes, then you have to optimize about what would be the densities in these additional regions. Okay, so you have to take the formula for the larger system and then specify the density inside and optimize on the density outside. So that's the way. Okay, so yes. And if I remember well, the density outside, in fact, will be linear. So you will have an optimal density for this part. And for, I don't know whether you see me. Can you see me?
Yes.
Okay, so you would need to optimize over the density profile on the two sides there. And
at the end, you get some closed formula.
Yes, maybe. Yes, probably. Okay, certainly you would be able to do it. I don't know how close it is, but you see, you just need. Yes, I would say yes. But
and the second question I have, these things that you say that it is the same as when you extend the system, it is also true, you think, even the case where you don't have nearest neighbor interactions?
I think that's very, very specific to the symmetric exclusion process. I believe this is based on this matrix on that I did not discuss here. Presumably, there is something similar you would be able to do on the TACEP or on the weekly ASEP and all that, you would be able to do the same because it's very much based on the matrix on that. But we have not done it. And the way it is, that certainly it will not be just that you see, if I think of the WASEP also, it will not be the correlation functions are such that it would not be that you just have an extra lens on the two sides. It would be something different that you would need to do, but I think with the matrix on that, you would be able to do it. And if you're interested, we can discuss it when I come back to, I can visit Nice and tell you more.
Okay, but you think that even at the macroscopic level, it will not be true. The thing that we are mentioning that you have to optimize on these row one and row two,
yes,
it could be independent of the model. Maybe it could be true for the class of models. No,
I would be surprised. Okay, this is really based on the calculation of the density profiles and all correlation functions. Now, if you take a more diffusive system, usually I don't know whether one can compute the correlation functions. Maybe okay. So
okay. Okay, there are no other questions in the room. So we can thank again Bernard for this nice talk.